This time, children, kindergarten through grade four, are dismissed for young worshipers in training. And while they're heading out, I just want to say a wonderful thank you. Scripture tells us that we're to teach one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And just standing up front here as the praise team selected the music this morning, but you sang it. And what a wonderful time just to be up front and close my eyes and just hear you teaching God's word through song, and we are shaped by that, and it's just wonderful. So thank you for teaching me this morning, reminding me of some great truths through song. Also want to welcome home Greg Donnelly. See Greg's here, and I had the privilege of being with the team that went to Greece for 1 week to minister to the refugees there. Greg, his ministry takes him to parts of the world to minister and lead ministries to refugees, and he's been gone for about 2 months, roughly. Yeah, so I'm sure he's just adjusting. You are in America right now, USA, and so glad you're home, brother, and welcome. Well, turn to Psalm 105. It's on page 503 if you're using the Bibles provided in the chairs. This summer, we're taking a series through the Psalms, some of the Psalms. We're not going to look at all 150 Psalms. It'd be hard to do that in the summer and get done. But we're going to look at different types of psalms as we journey through the summer months. And we've looked at psalms of praise, psalm of thanksgiving. This morning we're looking at an historical psalm. Psalm 105 is a psalm of history, and it's actually connected very close with Psalm 106. We're going to only look at one psalm this morning, 105, but if you were to take them both together, Psalm 105 and 106, they look at the same events in the history of Israel. They look at the time of the journey from slavery in Egypt, the exodus out of Egypt through the wilderness wandering into the promised land, that period of time in Israel's history from two different perspectives. Psalm 105 looks at the faithfulness of God. Psalm 106 looks at the faithlessness of God's people. And so this morning we're going to look at the faithfulness of God because that's a lot more fun to look at than the faithlessness of God's people. But just keep that in mind as we read these marks in the history of Israel. As the psalmist is declaring the glory of God, the faithfulness of God, it's a reminder how God's people are fickle, and God's people quickly turn away from walking in obedience and walking in faith. So we're going to look at Psalm 105 and just that reminder that God is 100% faithful to his word. He is 100% faithful 100% of the time. And God, there's no shifting sands. There's no changing of his mind. So let me read the psalm. It's a little bit long, but let me read it in its completeness, and then we'll take a look at how it breaks down for us. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. O offspring of Abraham, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations, the covenant that he made with Abraham, his sworn promise to Isaac, which he confirmed to Jacob as a statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying to you, I will give the land of Canaan as your portion for an inheritance. When they were few in number, of little account, and sojourners in it, wandering from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another people, he allowed no one to oppress them. He rebuked kings on their account, saying, touch not my anointed ones, do my prophets no harm. When he summoned a famine on the land and broke all supply of bread, he had sent a man ahead of them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. His feet were hurt with fetters, his neck was put in a collar of iron, until what he had said came to pass. The word of the Lord tested him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the people set him free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his possessions, to bind his princes at his pleasure and to teach his elders wisdom. Then Israel came to Egypt. Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham. And the Lord made his people very fruitful. and made them stronger than their foes. He turned their hearts to hate his people, to deal craftily with his servants. He sent Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen. They performed his signs among them and miracles in the land of Ham. He sent darkness and made the land dark. They did not rebel against his words. He turned their waters into blood and caused their fish to die. Their land swarmed with frogs, even in the chambers of their kings. He spoke, and there came swarms of flies and gnats throughout their country. He gave them hail for rain and fiery lightning bolts through their land. He struck down their vines and fig trees and shattered the trees of their country. He spoke, and the locusts came, young locusts without number, which devoured all the vegetation in their land and ate up the fruit of their ground. He struck down all the firstborn in their land, the first fruits of all their strength. Then he brought out Israel with silver and gold, and there was none among his tribes who stumbled. Egypt was glad when they departed, for dread of them had fallen upon it. He spread a cloud for a covering, and fire to give light by night. They asked, and he brought quail, and gave them bread from heaven in abundance. He opened the rock, and water gushed out. It flowed through the desert like a river, for he remembered his holy promise, and Abraham his servant. So he brought his people out with joy, his chosen ones with singing. And he gave them the lands of the nations, and they took possession of the fruit of the people's toil, that they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Praise the Lord. Let me pray. Father, as we read these words, it's history that in some ways is foreign to us. It's not our particular history of our lives, but for Israel, this was just a significant historical moment for them. And Lord, as we consider how you were faithful through Israel's history and have been and will be, and you've been faithful in our history, Father, may we look forward remembering that you are always faithful to your word and we can trust in you. May we glory in your name. May we lift up our names and declare to those around us the wonders of your works and your words and your judgments. May we give you the glory. May we praise the Lord. Amen. As I mentioned last week, you see the psalm is divided into different stanzas, and so we'll look at how it's broken down. The first six verses make the first stanza, and there's this call to praise and a call to remember. There's remember the works of the Lord. Look at the first four verses, and here we see nine commands to praise the Lord. And look at verse 1. It starts off, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord." It's a command. Give thanks. Think of all that God has done and lift up your voice in thanksgiving. Do we pause to thank? He's calling the people of Israel, thank the Lord. Thank him for what he's done. He goes on and commands them further. He says, call upon his name. Don't ignore the God who has brought you to this point. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Live it out. Proclaim it through your life. Make known God's deeds among the people, among your friends and family, among the church. Speak of him. Make known the wonderful works of God. Verse 2, sing to him. Sing praises. Tell of his wondrous words, wondrous works. Again, singing. Why do we sing? To tell of his wondrous works. These two commands go together. We sing his praises. We sing the works of God. We sing these words so that people might hear. Glory in his name, verse 3. And that goes right along with the next line. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Glory in him. Rejoice in him. May your life and your words praise him. And then seek, verse 4. Seek the Lord. Seek his strength. Seek his presence. And so in these couple verses, we have these commands. Give thanks. Call. Make known. Sing. Sing praises, tell, glory in him, rejoice in him, seek the Lord. So the psalm begins with this call to praise, to seek him. It's a reminder to God's people that we are to orient our lives around God. That from the moment we come to faith in Christ to the moment that we close our eyes and leave this world, our lives should be so oriented about Christ that we echo the words of Paul that for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Our lives should so reflect Christ. That's what this is a call to. It's this call to lifting up in all that we do the glory of God. to speak to his power and his faithfulness. And that's why it's closely connected with the command in number, or verse 5. Remember. Remember the wondrous works that he has done. Remember his miracles. Remember the judgments that he uttered. Remember that God has chosen you. Verse 6, O offspring of Abraham, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. Remember that God has, catch these words to Israel now. This is to the nation of God's people. Remember, Israel, remember, God has chosen you. God has, out of all the nations of the earth, God chose you. Not because of your innate worth, not because of your great abilities, not because of what you could do, but he chose you by his own good graces to be his people. The same is true for us. We are God's people, not because we're worthy, not because of there's something innately in us that makes us part of God's team. And he said, I want them because... You know, like when you pick a team for a sport and you pick the good ones first, you know, like when we're playing basketball and the friends who knew me, they would look at my height and they go, yeah, but we know we can't play. So he's the last one chosen, right? It's not like God looks at us and sees our talents and says, I want him. God looks at us and says, regardless of what you might think you bring nothing to me except for what I give you. Not yet, not I, but Christ in me, right? We sang that and taught each other that earlier. And that's a call to remember, and he's calling his people, he's proclaiming, the psalmist is saying, now remember who you are. You are God's chosen people. Sing his praises because he has done a wonderful work in you and through you. It's his work. Therefore, let's remember that and praise him. He goes on then in the next stanza, verses 7 through 11. Why do we remember? Why do we praise him? Because he established his covenant. He established his promise. Look at these verses here. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever. You see, it's a reminder that God remembers his works. The psalmist reminds the people of Israel about God's words, about his works. And first, it's the words here that he's reminding them. God's covenant is a promise. God's words, notice what he says in verse 8, he remembers his covenant, his promise, his words forever. The word that he commanded for 1,000 generations. Just think about that phrase for a moment. It's kind of a figurative thing for a long time, but a generation is thought to be about 20 years. All right. So 1,000 generations is 20,000 years. If we go by the genealogies in the Bible, Adam and Eve were about 6,000 years ago. So even that little phrase there says God's word goes beyond all of human history and so far beyond our comprehension. What God is doing, he's blowing our minds out and saying, my word goes beyond anything you can fathom. It stands forever and there's no end to it. What I have said, I will do. Why? Because I don't change. I've given my promise and my promise won't change. I am 100% faithful to my word 100% of the time and my promises will never fail. That's important for us to remember. It's important for Israel to remember. God's word doesn't change. His promises are not a fleeting thought. They stand forever. Next, he reminds them that it's not just that God's word is forever, not that the promises are forever, but God's covenant is personal. Look what he says here in verses 8 and 9. He says, it was established first with Abraham. And so their minds are going back now to the history of the Israeli people. Abraham was living among a foreign nation in Ur of the Chaldeans, and God calls him out of that land and establishes a covenant with him as he goes through Canaan and says, I will give you this land. I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, as numerous as the sand on the seashore. I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you, but I will also make you a blessing to all nations. And he establishes this covenant with Abraham. And then the psalmist says, not only with Abraham, though, but then also with Abraham's son Isaac and with his son Jacob as a statute. He's established it through these three generations. And then Jacob, who is given the name Israel by God and the father of the 12 tribes of Israel, the fourth line there, he establishes it with Israel. the very nation. So the covenant is personal. It's not just some word of God that's out there to stand. It's the word of God that means something to Israel because God has established it with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the tribes of Israel, the very nation of Israel. This is an everlasting covenant for God's people. This is very personal. And that's why you can go back up to verse 7 and see that it's a covenant with whom? He is the Lord our God. Notice the personal there. It's not just the Lord, the God of all creation. He is the Lord, our God. You see, this covenant is very personal. Third, he reminds them the covenant has a purpose. You see, the covenant of God was given to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and to all of Israel as an everlasting covenant. In verse 11, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as your portion for an inheritance. You see, God has established a covenant with Israel, and that covenant begins with the land. You know, God told Abraham, look, in all directions, this land I will give to you and your descendants as an inheritance. So it's the promise of land, and at the same time, he also promises them a nation. That they will be a nation that will be large and numerous. But here's the other part. He promises them that they will be a blessing to all nations. See, the covenant wasn't just about Israel. The covenant was missional in the sense that it was establishing Israel as a nation in the land that they might be a blessing through the coming of Christ one day to the world. Likewise, God has established his word with us. He has brought us into relationship with him through Jesus Christ, and he's established the church. He says, I am the Lord of the church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against the church, that the church might be in the world and be a light for me in the midst of the world. We have a mission that we've been given. You see, God hasn't chosen us for our own sake only. You see, God chose us. God works in our lives. He made himself known to us. He revealed himself to us. He revealed our sinfulness, our need to trust him as our Savior. Trust him for the forgiveness of sin, to be reconciled with him. He brings us to himself through the work of the Holy Spirit. So he reconciles us to us. It's personal. We are his people. He establishes the covenant with us forever. He makes the promise that he will be with us to the end of the age, Jesus says. So his presence is a promise to us. We've been called to God. We've been saved by God through faith in Christ Jesus. That we might live for his glory and his purpose. We have a mission. We have a mission to be a witness for Christ, to tell others of salvation, to bless others as we seek to lead others to salvation in Christ. So the psalmist establish the fact that God's covenant is forever, is personal, and it's got a purpose to it. And that's the same for us. And now he's going to go on. So he said, remember the words of God. We need to remember the words of God. Now he's going to say, remember the works of God. And the rest of the psalm, although it's broken into stanzas, is going to reflect for us the works of God, the faithfulness of God, even when his people would be faithless. So look down at verses 12 through 15. And this first section of this part talks about the fact that God protects his people. And this is historically in the Bible, if you were to go back and look at Genesis 12 through about chapter 38 of Genesis, these couple verses are summarizing those chapters of Scripture. And what it's saying is here's that time when Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were this one family, a growing family, but just one family, wandering nomadically through the land of Canaan, the promised land, but they hadn't inherited it yet. And they're wandering through the land, and they're vulnerable. They're vulnerable to all the nations that live there. If those nations wanted to, they could just crush them because they're small in number. They don't have an army. They don't have hundreds of soldiers. So they're wandering. But we see that God is faithful to his word, faithful to his promise, faithful to his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he lets no one destroy his word and his work. And he protects his people according to the purposes and promises that he's made. So that, what does the psalmist say? So that no one can harm them. So we see that God's people, in the midst of this, God's people are not faithful. You read about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and their failings, and they're not a perfect people. Even to the point where we see the psalmist says, and he rebukes kings on their behalf. Well, the rebuking of the king is because Abraham lied about his wife, saying that she's my sister, and so the king took her to be his own wife. And God rebukes the king because of that, right? So in the midst of that, God is protecting his people, protecting his word, faithful to his covenant promise to his people. God is faithful. Now, God does not protect his people from every trial and from every suffering. See, we can take this and say, well, see, God protects his people, therefore I can do whatever I want, and God is going to protect me. God is going to, you know, guard my life. And God doesn't protect his people from every trial, from suffering. But as far as his purpose and his plan is concerned, he would protect his people, and he does so today. So his people as a whole were established. The nation of Israel was born and would grow and would produce a Savior for the world. Likewise today, God protects us according to his purpose. Doesn't mean that we won't suffer. In fact, throughout history and today in parts of the world, Christians are suffering for their faith in Christ. And so this is not a prosperity gospel saying if you're faithful enough to Jesus, he's going to protect you. Though I've heard missionaries declare it, I know it's true. There's no safer place to be than in the will of God. And though you take my life, you cannot take my faith in Christ. My witness in Christ will stand. And so God protects us according to his covenant. As Christ declared, the church will always prevail. His church. The gates of hell will not prevail against his church. We're called to be part of his church, his people. And we're to declare his word through our words and our lives. May we be spent for Christ. And may our lives be given for the sake of the gospel. And they say that we as a people, we want a cause. What greater cause to invest our lives in than the cause of Christ? I was thinking about our church here, Faith Bible Fellowship Church. It was established 122 years ago. We are over a century old. How was it established? The preaching of God's word, the teaching of God's word, the proclamation through lives and words of God's word. And God established this church, and this church has grown, it's declined, and it's grown, it's declined, it's plateaued at times. We've had over 30 different pastors serve in different roles throughout the years, preachers, elders, deacons, Sunday school teachers, men and women have come and gone, but the preaching of the word of God, the teaching of the word of God has remained constant. The proclamation of God's word, because this is not our church. We may change the look of the building. We may change the look of how we gather to worship, those kind of things. But this is not our church. This is God's church. This is the Lord's church. And may he continue to protect the proclamation of his word in this place. May he guard that. May we guard it. Because it's important to him. The second section of this historical recounting here of the works of God talks about God preparing his people, verses 16 through 36. I'm not going to read it all, but this part covers from about Genesis 38 up through the beginning of Exodus, the first few chapters of Exodus. This is a time in Israel's history filled with great hardship. We talk about protecting his people, and yet in the midst of this, we see God protecting and preparing his people for what he's going to do. You see, God is going to lead them into some great hardship. We begin, when he, God, summoned a famine on the land and broke all supply of bread, he had sent a man ahead of them, Joseph, who sold as a slave. So who's Joseph? Joseph was one of the 12 sons of Jacob, one of the fathers of the tribes of Israel. And Joseph was, for various reasons, hated by his brothers. 10 of the other brothers hated him. I don't know if I can say that severely enough. They hated him. They beat him, and some wanted to kill him. Others convinced him, no, let's not kill him. Let's profit from this. Let's sell him into slavery and be done with him that way. They committed evil against their brother, to say the least. And look how the psalmist describes this here. Joseph sold as a slave with his feet fettered and his neck, a collar of iron around his neck. I mean, he's in pain. This is not a joyous trip into Egypt. He was sold as a slave. He was treated as a slave. It is painful. It is hardship. He spent years as a slave, and then he was falsely accused, spent years in prison before Pharaoh had a dream that couldn't be interpreted. And only by God's grace and God's insight and wisdom was Joseph able to interpret that dream, and it elevated Joseph from being in prison to being second in the command of Egypt. Just at the time, now this is coincidence, isn't it? Just at the time that famine hits all of Canaan and all of Egypt, Joseph is second in the land of Egypt and ruling over all the food. Coincidence, right? Now, it's God's faithfulness to his covenant promise. He prepared the way with Joseph going to Egypt. He gave Joseph the wisdom. He gave Joseph the insight. He gave Joseph the knowledge to be able to interpret a dream, but also then to administer all the work of collecting food for 7 years, so they're ready for 7 years of famine. And so when the nation of Israel, this family of 70 or so, learns that there's food in Egypt, they go down and they get food. And through a series of events, God leads them to Egypt to settle for a time. Now understand, what also takes place in the midst of this is Joseph understood God was at work. You see, we have to use our imaginations a bit, because we're not told what's going on in Joseph's heart when he's first sold into slavery. But by the time his brothers get there, and they come before him trying to kind of manipulate him again, but Joseph picks it all up. He says, listen, Genesis 50 verse 20, what you did, you meant for evil. No mincing of words here. You meant it for evil. But I'm not in the place of God. I forgive you because God was doing something else. You see, God brought me here to save you, to save his people, to prepare his people. You see, Joseph understood that God was at work, even in the midst of his hardships. And there's times that I can imagine he didn't feel God's presence, though it says he always walked with God, that he was faithful, and God was walking with him. So Israel now is in Egypt, and this is a place where they're in a fertile land of Egypt, the land of Goshen. They can grow. They grow to be millions by the time they leave Egypt 400 years later. But in the midst of that, they grow beyond number, so now Egypt is scared. And what do? They treat them cruelly, and the psalmist says that. So they grew. As they grow in number against their foe now, their enemy treats them cruelly. They make them slaves. They work them hard for 400 years. The nation of Israel was there longer than our country's been in existence. Just trying to put it in our historical perspective. You know, our 1776 is when we declared our independence, right? So my quick math tells me it's about 250 years, roughly. 400-some years. All right. So in the time of slavery, as they're being treated cruelly and harshly, did they know God was with them? Did they feel his presence? Was it all pleasant? I would say there was probably seasons where they did not feel God's presence. They weren't feeling the prosperity of God's great blessing on their nation, but they grew. And God was preparing them for when he was going to bring them out. In the midst of that, God was still at work. God remembered his covenant. God remembered his people. He knew them. He understood where they're at. And they're facing hardship. And they may not have felt God, but he was there. And the They cry out to him. We're told it in Exodus, they cry out, and God then brings Moses and Aaron. And what's recorded for us here is 8 of the 10 plagues. Not sure why they didn't include boils. I mean, it just was kind of disgusting to put in a poem. But 8 of the plagues are recorded for us here, finishing with the death of the firstborn. And even in that, God is preparing his people, because as God is bringing plagues on Egypt, there's certain plagues that were specifically told. God brought that plague on the people of Egypt, but he kept his people Israel from that plague. And in the midst of the plagues, God's preparing his people, saying, listen, I am greater than every god of Pharaoh, every god of Egypt, every human power. The greatest king on earth right now, Pharaoh, is nothing compared to my power. Do you trust me? I'm faithful to my word. I'm faithful to my people. You see, God was preparing his people. He continued to prepare them for what he was going to do and what he was doing in their midst. God prepares his people. And I think, again, over our history, we began in the late 1900s at a tent meeting. And then we moved to the small schoolhouse down Main Street, I guess it is, then to Maple Avenue and the chapel, and now to this building. We've had times of hardships, budget deficits, leadership failures and sins, times of growth and decline or just plateauing. But God has been faithful, preparing us as his people, establishing us with his purposes of leading people in the Harleysville area to Christ, to know him, to grow in him, and to make others know him, to lead others to know him as we do. It's our mission. God has been preparing us for that work and continues to prepare us for the work of making disciples. That's our call. The last section of the psalm here reminds us that God provides for his people. He brought Israel out with silver and gold. I love this. So God provided the finances that the people were going to need as they leave Egypt. They're going to be wandering for, God knows they're going to be wandering for 40 years because they're not faithful. You read Psalm 106 and it's just line after line. Every stanza begins with, and they didn't do this, or they complained, or they, all right. So God knew they're going to be wandering for 40 years and they're going to need some things. And actually they're going to make a tabernacle that's going to be glorious, and they need gold and silver, and the Egyptians provide it for them. All right. In fact, you get the picture here. Now, God has so brought his plagues on Egypt and his wrath on Egypt that when the Israelites leave, the Egyptians are like, go get out. Hey, here's my gold. Go. All right? Dread had fallen on them. They were glad to see Israel get out. Like, finally, no more of these plagues. And God leads them out. God provides for them with the gold and silver, but even more importantly, look, it says God spread over them, verse 39, a cloud for covering and fire to give light by night. We always think of the cloud that they had during the day and the fire by night to lead them, and that was true. It went before them. When it rose up, they were to rise up, and they were to go out behind it. But also the cloud, as they're wandering through the desert, the cloud provided cover, protection from the blaring heat of the sun. The fire at night not only provided guidance, but provided light in the darkness, perhaps even heat in the cool of the desert nights. You see, even in the midst of the signs that God gave for leading, he also provided for them, not just guidance, but provided for their daily needs. And then he gave them, they asked, and he brought quail. He gave them meat. He gave them bread from heaven. We call it manna. He opened the rock when they needed water, and water gushed out of the rock for them like a river. God provided food and water, the sustenance, the things that they needed for their daily life. God knew what they needed. He provided it. And then it says that he brought them to the land. He provided a land for them. They come out of Egypt and they're 2 million strong, and now he provides them a land where they can settle. The promised land. The nations that were there, it says that their sin had come to its fullness, its fulfillment. And so the wrath of God on sin is on display as the people of Israel are to conquer that land. As God's chosen people, they're to bring the wrath and settle in that land. And we're told they didn't do it faithfully, but that's Psalm 106. You see, God was faithful. But look what it says here. He brought them out with joy. Chosen ones with singing, verse 43. 45, 44, he gave them the lands. That, verse 45, that. Here's that purpose. Why did God give them land? That they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. He gives them a land, establishes them as people, that they might live in obedience to him, not in some way of earning salvation, but that their lives would be different, that they would be set apart, that the nations around them would look at this people that God gave a land to, and they're different. They're established by God, living for God, and their lives are so different. I want to be part of that community. That they might be a blessing for all nations. That the Messiah would come through them. And God has protected us as a church. He has prepared us as a church. He's provided for us as a church. I've had the privilege over the 26 years that I've served here to serve with men that are serving as elders and deacons that are just godly men. And God has provided great leaders in this church, godly men and women who teach the Word of God, faithful servants to coordinate the various ministries of the church. God has provided us people that are faithful in reaching out to our neighborhood, to caring for one another. God has provided for us financially through faithful giving. God has provided for us a great property and a location. Why? See, there's a purpose in all that. God's provided it, not just for us to enjoy it, because then we get self-focused. And that's not why we've been given the things we've been given. God has provided these things that we might know him, grow in him, and make him known. Are we being faithful? Are we being faithful to the calling that God has given us? We're to praise him. We're to remember his words and his works in our midst. Just as he was with Abraham, with Israel, through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Israel, he has been faithful to us. He's working in our lives individually. He's working in our church. He's preparing us and providing for us and protecting us that we might be his missionaries in our community. We're being faithful. I want to kind of conclude this morning with thinking through this a little more personal. I want to invite Abby, if she'd come up at this time and begin to play something on the keyboard to kind of fill the room a little bit with some music, because I want you to take some time personally now. Think about your own historic psalm. The psalmist walked us through Israel's historic psalm. How has God been at work in your life? Because I know some of you right now are in the midst of kind of that time of a season of slavery, that hardship that Israel experienced. Maybe God's presence, you don't feel it. So what's good in that time is to look back and say, how do I see God at work in my life? The person, maybe my parents who taught me about Christ, or the person who led me to Christ, or the time when I just saw God's hand at work through teaching and leading me and helping me to grow. Maybe pull out a piece of paper and jot down some of your own historic psalm for a moment. Remembering the words of God, remembering the works of God. What words, what scriptures has God put on your heart through the years that have just sustained you and reminded you of his promises? But take a moment, and then I'll close this out with prayer. But this is kind of a prayerful time for you to kind of write your own historic psalm. Don't worry about the poetry and all that other kind of stuff. Just events, just kind of bullet point. If you want to be poetic, you can. But this is time for you. Thinking through what we just saw in Israel's history, now make it more personal. How has God been faithful to you? Because God is 100% faithful 100% of the time. And as we look back, we see his faithfulness. Then it allows us to look forward. No matter what we're facing, we can look forward trusting in his faithfulness. Take a moment. Consider those things. Oh, great God and Savior, I thank you. Lord, in my own personal life, I just praise you for my parents who taught me about Christ, took me to church from the time I was a boy. Thank you for the preacher that came and preached one Sunday and led me into ministry. I thank you for the godly woman that you gave me as a wife, who's walked this journey with me and many times been one who has taught me so much about faith and trusting you. Thank you for this church, the way you've worked in our midst for decades. But Lord, even in the recent years, the men and women of this church that you've used to shape me, continue to transform me more and more into the image of Christ, prepare me, protect me, and provide in my life that I might minister for you. Lord, I see your hand of faithfulness in my life personally, through the history of my life. And Lord, I thank you for your hand of faithfulness in the life of our church. And Lord, as we look forward individually and as a church, we don't know what's ahead, but you do. And Lord, you will be faithful to your word and your work all the time. Lord, may we trust you. May we pursue you. May we seek to know you, to trust you, to grow in you, and make you known to the world around us. We ask that you be glorified in all we do. Amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve Him.